chapter 2 of our current series, Nebuchadnezzar showed himself to be a real arrogant kind of a guy. Chapter 3, our text for today, shows he's still full of himself. Take your Bibles, please, and turn to Daniel chapter 3. We're going to look at the entire chapter, although not in great detail in some parts. But I do want to give you the story as we continue to look at Nebuchadnezzar and his issues. Daniel chapter 3, verses 1 through 30. I was talking to my wife about the message, being married to a pastor. I'm assuming it's true for Brother Roberto, too, but you hear about the message throughout the week, so I was kind of bouncing things off the missus, and we were talking about the story. She said, where was Daniel? Because we got this Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, right? They're the focus of chapter 3. And Daniel, of course, was all over chapter 1 and chapter 2. Well, the answer is in the text. Look at chapter 2, verse 49. Also, Daniel petitioned the king, and he set Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego over the affairs of the province of Babylon. But Daniel sat in the gate of the king in the capital of Babylon. In chapter 3, verse 1, the action turns to a plain in Dura. Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold, whose height was 60 cubits and its width 6 cubits. He set it up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. And then he invited all these famous and important people to come. So Daniel is at his appointed place in the city. He's not here. If he was here, he would have done the same thing that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did in refusing to bow down. But we have this whole very familiar chapter, and Nebuchadnezzar makes a giant statue. It's 90 feet high by 9 feet wide. He covers it with gold. I don't think it was solid gold, though some think it was. I think it was more gold embossed or covered. But he has this gold statue, and he's going to tell everybody to bow down and worship this idol. And that causes a big problem for those who follow the true God, Jehovah. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are going to refuse to do this. We know the story, right? But the text was given as a model for Israel to stand firm against this kind of arrogance and this pagan worship. And we're going to apply it to ourselves as well, because it's the same message for us, because we too are tempted to give in to the things of the world. And we need to stand fast and stand firm. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the privilege of opening your word again. Thank you for Daniel and for his message for us today. How relevant is it to have a story of young men who've been taken from their home and are placed in a godless culture, in a pagan society, and they need to stand for you in the midst of the onslaught of a world that knows you not. How relevant is that to us today, who also live in a culture that is certainly post-Christian, if there was ever Christian at all, and we are now seen as certain lights in the darkness, and the darkness does not understand or appreciate the light. And so we can make absolute and immediate and practical application. May we do that today, as your Spirit would enable us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. First thing I want you to say, just right up front, let's state for the issue. Sometimes resistance to authority can't be avoided. Now, I read chapter 3, verse 1. You look at chapter 3, 2, and King Nebuchadnezzar sent word to gather together the satraps, the administrators, the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the judges, the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image which King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. So the satraps, the administrators, the governors, all of them, came and stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Verse 4, then a herald cried aloud, to you it is commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages, that at the time you hear the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery, in symphony with all kinds of music, you shall fall down and worship the gold image that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. So at that time, when all the people heard the sound of the horn, the flute, harp, and lyre, in symphony with all kinds of music, all the people, all the nations, all the languages fell down and worshipped the gold image which King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. All but three, right? We're going to read on further and see that. Part of living a holy life means resisting unholiness in the society at large. But we need to be careful how we proceed in this. There are some things in life that cramp my style. I don't like my style being cramped. there are some rules that I think are just silly. Do you have any silly laws that you can think of? In our city, you need to have a sticker on every car. And it's not a free sticker. It costs money. This year it went up. Now, that's a law. That's an ordinance. That's a regulation that the city has put in place. It's been there many years. Nobody I know likes that law. Many people I know ignore that law. But if you look at my car, you'll see the sticker on time every 2 years. I buy it. I don't complain. I talk nicely to the lady at the sticker counter and the whole thing. Why? It's a law that I don't really appreciate, but it's not worth fighting. I'm going to pay the money and I'm going to put the sticker on the car. I asked the police what purpose it serves. You know what the answer was? None. I said, if my car is lost, can you find it through the sticker? No, it's just a money maker. That's fine. City needs it a lot. So go ahead and do it, right? I don't park my car outside from 2 to 6 a.m. Why? Because I get a ticket if I do that. Do I like that law? When I remember at 3:30 that my car is out there, all of a sudden you wake up. Did you move the car? No, did you move the car? And you go out and there's an opportunity to contribute to the deficit of the city, right? I don't like it, but I do it, right? There's some laws that they serve some purpose, I guess, but I'm not going to march on City Hall. I'm not going to start a boycott of Zion. I'm not going to protest. I'm not going to vote against somebody who has it. I just do it. In these and other areas, we can just go along with the authority. It's no harm, no foul, right? It's not a big deal. My sister lives out in the country. I tell her about some of the rules we have in the city, and she's just stupefied, because in the country, you can pretty much do whatever you want. If you want to burn garbage, go burn it. You want to burn the back 20, go burn them. You know, there's not a whole lot of laws. We have a lot of laws. We have laws for everything, but that's okay. Daniel and the other guys here originally followed all the Babylonian script. Remember in chapter 1 when they said you have to learn our culture? Did they want to learn the culture? I'm betting not. They learned it. You got to speak our language. Did they want to learn the language of the pagan culture? I doubt it, but they learned it. Remember? But then the king said, you need to eat food offered to idols. And that was a bridge too far. This we can, that we can't. We talked about that when we were in chapter 1, right? This goes along with what it says in Romans 13:1. Let every soul be subject to the governing authorities. For there is no authority except from God. And the authorities that exist are appointed by God. So that means that police officer that pulls you over because you're going 30 and a 20 on the Sheridan Raceway should be respected, because he's doing the Lord's business. Because the authorities have been given to us by God. So in general, we are respectful to the authority. We don't go against every little problem. We might think it's a silly law. We might think it's applied unfairly. You grin and bear and pay it. However, and as you and I know, there are some times that we need to stand against the authority. Like Daniel did in chapter 1. Like the apostles did in Acts. Remember when the authority said to Peter and the apostles, stop preaching in Jesus' name. I've never had somebody tell me to stop doing that. I hope I never do. But if they tell me to stop preaching in Jesus' name, I'm going to stand behind the pulpit. In fact, I might get the really big Roberto 5000 pulpit. It's going like this. And I'm going to preach with all my heart, because you can pull me out, you can drag me down, you can lock me up, but I'm going to disobey that, because the Lord says that we should share the gospel. And I know you understand the same way. That's what we see. Read the verse with me. Acts 5, 28 and 29. Did we not strictly command you not to teach in this name? And look, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine, and you intend to bring this man's blood on us. Read the last part with me, please. But Peter and the apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. So if the city of Zion makes a rule that we need to have one drinking fountain for every 50 people in the church, we're going to put another one in. We'll appeal it. We'll send Howard down there, because he's got connections from back in the day. And we'll say, really? You really think we have to have it? But if we lose the battle, we're going to put the drinking fountain in. Why? Because it's just not worth fighting over. But if they say, you cannot preach the gospel, stop this Jesus stuff, every single one of us here would say, that's something I have to disobey. And if I didn't, if the leaders didn't, you would replace us as leaders. Because there are certain things that we cannot do. And that's what's happening here. Let's talk about this whole statue. Building the statue was sinful. It was inspired by Nebuchadnezzar's earlier dream. Remember back in chapter 2 and verse 38, the whole amazing interpretation of the dream, right? And it says in chapter 2:38 to the Nebuchadnezzar, "You are the head of gold." Remember, there was the head of gold, and there was silver and bronze and iron mixed with clay. He was the top. He was the top banana. He was the gold head. And because of that, I believe it influenced him to do this terrible thing and put up this monstrosity of a statue. Here's the twist. He didn't like the part about empires someday taking his place. He liked the fact that he was in charge. He liked being the head. He liked being gold. But he didn't want the silver, because that meant he's gone and somebody else is in. He didn't like the bronze. He didn't like the others. So he made a statue entirely of gold. What's he saying? Nobody's taking my place. God is wrong. I'm not going to allow that to happen. I'm negating that prophecy that Daniel gave from God. As far as I'm concerned, it's me always and only. And so he was making something about himself. I believe that there was the reason he built the statue certainly was related to the dream that he had had. Now, I don't know how long it was between chapter 2 and chapter 3. A short time. Some people say it might have been a few years. But I do know that this was certainly in his mind. I believe this was in his mind. He refused to accept God's plan for history. That is arrogance. And so building the statue, just building it, was sinful because it was arrogant. Now, it was 90 feet high, 9 feet wide, which is a gross distortion of the human body. If you get a body that tall, it's not going to be that wide. It's going to be a lot wider. I don't think that the statue was 90 feet tall. I think it was erected on a very large pedestal, so that the height of the pedestal with the statue was 90 feet. It was a huge statue, but I believe that it was more the sense that 90 feet high was the whole package, and 9 feet wide. Some people tell us that it was a statue of Nebuchadnezzar. I don't believe that either. The Babylonians were not known for worshiping their kings. They didn't believe in divine kings and worship. So I believe it was probably one of their local false gods. But he certainly was using it as a loyalty pledge. If you support me, you will bow down to the statue that I have placed up. In fact, we saw that in chapter 3. They do not support your gods or the statue. And so it's talking, I believe, more about pagan gods. 7 groups of leaders were summoned to Dura. They're listed in descending order of rank, verses 2 and 3. So the highest, there will be the satraps, and then the administrators, the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the judges, the magistrates, and the officials. And so it's all these people are being invited, or representatives of them, certainly, to this great plain. And that's what we see going on. It's a religious ceremony, because there are 6 types of instruments used. And in verses 4 and 5, there's a call to worship. But it's not like we did here. We call people to worship the true God. There was music. If there was, a religious ceremony, I don't see them with an offering plate, but that might have been there too. Where 2 or 3 are gathered, you know, we cast a plate. But I do know that it was a pagan religious ceremony. When the music starts, you will bow down and worship this idol, this image. And everybody went along with it, because verse 6 says, if you don't do it, you'll be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. So building the statue was sinful. Bowing down to the statue would be sinful as well. So Nebuchadnezzar was sinful in building the thing. What am I saying here? Because it was sinful, he should be disobeyed. Bowing down to the statue would be sinful. Because bowing down is sinful, that edict should be disobeyed. God made it clear to his people that they were not to have any other gods before him. So this worship idol was a grievous sin. So with all this sinfulness floating around, the situation was rife for the kind of resistance to authority that these men showed. Look at verse 8 to 12. Therefore, at that time, certain Chaldeans came forward and accused the Jews. They spoke and said to King Nebuchadnezzar, "O king, live forever. You, O king, have made a decree that everyone who hears the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery, in symphony with all kinds of music, shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace." So far, they're just telling what he already knows. Verse 12, there are certain Jews. Why did they mention the Jews, by the way? There's a real ethnic slur going on here. Why does it matter? There are certain Jews whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not paid due regard to you. They do not serve your gods or worship the gold image which you have set up. So there's some snitches in the crowd, and they come and they tell the king that these three men, these three Hebrews, have refused to bow down. Now, there's a picture I had in my mind, and I emailed or called my secretary. I was in Massachusetts enjoying vacation, which went very well, by the way. And I asked her to find this picture, and she did very well finding it. I want you to see here in the picture. Here's a statue. And these would be Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You see this guy right here? Everybody else is bowing down. I thought that was really interesting. When I first saw that painting years ago on a record album, so you know how long ago, because we don't have records anymore. I guess they're back in. But I thought how fascinating it was that there was somebody at least saying to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you dummies, get down on your knees. They're going to see you. He's coming by right now. Somebody. There was peer pressure. Everybody else is just prostrate on the ground. Here's these three guys, and their friend is saying, did you not hear? Do you have cotton in your ears? Get down. You're going to die. Do you want to be burned up in a fiery furnace? Get down here. And they're shaking them off. They're saying, no, we did this on purpose. Thank you very much. So they stuck to their guns, and the king went ballistic. The king's always going ballistic. He's got a real problem with anger. Well, why is that? Because here's the second point. So resistance sometimes can't be avoided, but resistance is never appreciated. Am I right? Leaders want to be followed. If you don't follow a leader, then you're not a leader. Right? Especially a despot like this king. And so they don't like being ignored. He gave us a law. He gave a rule. And these three guys disobeyed, which signed their death warrant, by the way. But they made a decision, and there was no going back. So the king brought them in for some personal arm twisting. Look at verse 13. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in rage and fury, again, that's Nebi, rage and fury, gave the command to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they brought these men before the king. And Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying, I don't know why he brought them in, by the way. Maybe he thought that they were dense and didn't figure it out. Maybe I'm going to make an example of these three. He brings them in. Verse 14, he spoke, saying to them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the gold image which I have set up? Now, if you are ready at the time you hear the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery, and symphony with all kinds of music, and if you fall down and worship the image which I have made, good. But if you do not worship, you shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is the God that will deliver you from my hand? Now, there's the arrogance again, right? He talked about this God in chapter 2 and said he was like all that. He was like the revealer of secrets, remember? And he said, everybody should listen to the God of Daniel. He's the revealer of secrets. But now he's saying, God, Shmad, I don't need fear any God. So he gives him the same message, the same instruments. He lists them for, it must have been a union group. Each one had to be listed. He gives all six of them. When it happens, here's what you will do. And if you don't, it's verse 6 all over again. You will be cast into the midst of a burning, fiery furnace. But you know something? He couldn't dissuade them. I love verse 16. Don't you love verse 16? It says this. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. What are they saying? There is nothing to discuss here. We heard, we made a decision, and we're sticking with it. They said very clearly and categorically to the king, we're not going to talk about this. We're not going to consider this. You can't change our minds. They're made up. The matter is settled. No promise is going to soften our stand, and no threat is going to derail it. Because God's will was their only priority. Now, I want you to see how important it is, because we're getting to the nub of the message. All right? It's a little difficult for a pastor to share a text that is so familiar. I mean, if I said Daniel 3 and fiery furnace, you could all preach to me from all the Sunday school on sermon, right? You could have a long group sermon here. What is it that we're trying to get to here? And I believe it's very important for us to understand that what they're getting to is that these three men cared about one thing and one thing only, the will of God. God said, you will have no other gods before me. That's it. They didn't ask for a little more explanation. Lord, what do you mean by that? And how about this? And I was talking to somebody a few weeks ago who's not a believer, I don't think. We talked about what we would do if somebody came up to us and took a gun and pointed it to our head and said, renounce Christ or I'm going to kill you. What would we do? And I said, I believe what I would do. I hope what I would do. I trust. I mean, I've never been there before, so I don't want to be arrogant, but I believe, and I very strongly, I would say, you're going to have to pull that trigger because I won't renounce Christ. This guy said to me, what you should do is renounce Christ and later ask for forgiveness. I said, okay, well, that's one way out of it. But can you see people saying that to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Maybe the guy pulling him down says, you know, I know you don't believe in this God, but just pretend. No one's going to know. Just half bow. Give him a little curtsy, you know? I mean, don't we do that with problems in this life? Though God says don't do something, we find ways to kind of half our way back in. It was all or nothing, but they were concerned about the will of God because God would know. Now, Jesus did the same thing. Remember, Jesus said, I always do those things that please the Father. He said, I have come to do thy will. Jesus set his face like a flint, and there was nothing that could dissuade him. So when Peter said, don't let it be true that you're going to be killed in Jerusalem, he said, get behind me, Satan, because I refuse. I refuse not to die. I refuse to listen to you because I am following the will of my Father. And that was the same thing with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And we should do the same. You know, for a person who talks for a living, I'm going to say something that sounds really weird. There's a time for words and a time for deeds. There's a time for words and a time for deeds. These men's calm demeanor in the face of certain death preached a message more powerful than a lengthy sermon. Look again at that. All they said was this, verse 17. If that is the case, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And he will deliver us from your hand if he wants to, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your God, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up. And then there was silence. And I picture this glow on the face. Maybe it's the glow reflecting from the furnace just a few feet away. But what a message that was. Because here's what Nebuchadnezzar is learning about God. I'm working on a message of Nebuchadnezzar's Odyssey of Faith. In chapter 2, where he's not saved, but he's getting there. In chapter 3, where he's not saved, but he's closer. In chapter 4, where I think he really comes to faith in the true God. It's an interesting thing to see, because I think a lot of other people follow that same pattern. But at this particular point, he has heard about Daniel's God. Remember in chapter 2:47, he said, your God. It wasn't his God. He's a revealer of secrets. But now he's going to see that there's more to it. That this God expects entire devotion from his people. And there are people in his kingdom willing to give it. He's going to learn something brand new. He's going to see something that's going to eye-poppingly astonish him. Because here are these men, nothing. They're not dumb. They've had him very clearly explained to them, and yet they're looking him in the face and saying, we will not do this. We're not afraid of you. So he tried to dissuade them, and he couldn't. So the next thing he did was he tried to destroy them. And that's what we see as he gets this furnace going. Now, let me talk about the furnace, okay? As I was doing some research, I tried to get a picture back to Zion Grace Missionary Church office. I couldn't get it to come, but I found some images in my search that the furnace of the time, and they had pictures of it, or drawn, certainly. It was like an old-fashioned milk bottle. So there was an opening at the top where they would put the ore in to be smelted, and then it would be kind of like this, come down, and there was an opening in the front, and there was little holes in the back where they put the bellows in. Let's be real practical here. How do you turn the heat up? You don't have ComEd piping this stuff in. So they put coal, charcoal, or wood, and they would get the bellows going. Last night we had a bonfire. We got back and Savannah had her 10th birthday, so the family invited us down for a bonfire. And I was talking about heating it 7 times hotter than it. I was kind of preaching my sermon. And here was Katie with a frisbee. I thought she was going to throw it in at first, like she's always hated frisbees, you know. But she got this, and she was doing this, trying to get the heat, or trying to get the oxygen. It was like a bellows. Okay? So the idea is there. So I was trying to make it spiritual. It wasn't working. It was all about marshmallow and chocolate and graham crackers, as I could tell. But I was trying to make it a spiritual experience for them, getting ready for today. But he tried to destroy them with this furnace, so there would be this, the ore, even the gold that was melted for the image was probably smelted in this furnace. And they would take it out with utensils, and they would use that and form it, and it would cool. So it's right nearby. They put it by a hill or on a mound, and that's how they would do this. So as we look at this here, the king is overheated again, and so he overheats the furnace, and we see that here in verse 19. Then Nebuchadnezzar was full of fury. I thought he was full of fury in the earlier verses. He's fuller of fury. And the expression on his face changed towards Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Maybe he was trying to find a way because he figured they were, again, slow. But now he's angry, he's hateful, he spoke and commanded that they heat the furnace 7 times more than it was usually heated. You know, as I was studying that, that's an expression that was used. It doesn't literally mean that they turned it up 7 times. Think about your furnace at the house. If you went as high as your furnace, your thermostat could go, what is it, 90? I don't know. Could you crank it another 7 times and have 9 times 7, which is, I still don't know how much that is. They tried to help me in Sunday school this morning, but I don't do math well. The idea was, here's what it meant. He said, heat the furnace as hot as possible. That's what he was saying. 7 times, 10 times, 4 times, it doesn't matter. I want that thing hot. I want that thing bellowed hot. And some of these furnaces could go as high as 1,800 degrees Fahrenheit. That is hot. I don't care how many times the normal is, that's just hot. And so he got upset, and he said, I want you to do this. He commanded certain men, verse 20. These were mighty men of valor. These were not little wimpy, wimpy, wimpies. They were in the army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Where are they going to cast them? Well, in the top. That was the entrance, and then they would look and see what happened in the bottom, by the ground level, this opening. So these men were bound in their coats, their trousers, their turbans, and their other garments. They were just wrapped right up like a pig in a blanket, and they were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. But because the king's command was urgent, and the furnace exceedingly hot, the flame of the fire killed those men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, let me name them again, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. So that's how they got there. These mighty men took them up there. It was so hot that it consumed the men that were carrying them, and they dropped them as they died, and these two men tumbled, rolled, flopped into this fiery furnace. Can you imagine for a moment how you would feel if your name was either Shadrach, Meshach, or Abednego? Though you've made a stand for God, and you know it's right, do you think they had any fear? Do you think they were human? It'd be a terrible thing to be trussed up like that. They didn't fight it because they were committed. But as they were going up, say, what were they thinking? And as they fell in, the whole thing is just a whole lot between the lines that we could read. But it's an amazing picture for us to see what happened. So the king tried to destroy them. But I want you to see that a greater king delivered them. A greater king delivered them. In a dramatic and a personal way. Can you imagine Nebuchadnezzar's shock? I mean, the royal doctor probably had to be called because his heart's going out of rhythm here. In verse 24, then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished, and he rose in haste, and he spoke, saying to his counselors, did we not cast 3 men bound into the midst of the fire? And they answered and said to the king, duh. No, they said, true, O king. Look, he answered, I see 4 men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt. And the form of the 4th is like the Son of God. I don't know what your translation says. Mine, New King James, says capital S, capital G. But the actual meaning, this is a pagan king. He doesn't know about the Son of God. He was saying it was a son of the gods. He believed it must have been a deity. Because of, well, for obvious reasons. But he wasn't talking about the one that we know was there. The one we know there was the Son of God, right? But he just saw this, and to him it was an apparition. It couldn't be the case. And they weren't bound anymore, but they were walking around. So here's a representation of it. As you can see there, obviously, there's 4 in the flame. Here's the king. So some of his rulers around there, they're just waiting. I don't know what they hoped to see, because 1,800 degrees, by the time they fell to the bottom, there was nothing to fall, right? But anyway, I guess they wanted to see an empty fireplace, but what they saw was these three guys and a fourth, and they were walking around. Like living in a furnace is a normal thing. It's like a walk at the beach, right? And so he was astonished, and of course he would be. But it was Jesus. It was an Old Testament Jesus. It was the Son of God, capital S, capital G. We know this Jesus. He's the Jesus that we preach and that we share the gospel about. And he was there with these three. And so he told, the king says, get out of there. Come on out. And so he says that here in 26. Then Nebuchadnezzar went near the mouth of the burning fiery furnace. He spoke, saying, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out and come here. It's interesting, he didn't talk to the fourth one. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came from the midst of the fire, and the satraps, the administrators, governors, and the king's counselors gathered together, and they saw these men on whose bodies the fire had no power, and the hair of their head was not singed, nor were their garments affected, and the smell of fire was not even on them. And Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him. And they have frustrated the king's word and yielded their bodies that they should not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Wow, good speech, Nebuchadnezzar. You're getting there. In this experience, these three men experienced the promise of Isaiah 43 and verse 2. Would you read that one with me? When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. And when you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flames scorch you. What an extraordinary answer to that, or fulfillment of that promise. And I believe that God is with us even today. In any fiery trial, in any temptation, in any persecution, Jesus is there with us. So we see that resistance sometimes can't be avoided. We see that resistance will not be appreciated. But there's one more thing, and I want you to get to, really, I'm going to go back to give us what I think is the main thing here. So I'm working on the message, and I'm asking God what he wants me to share. That's how I do it. I pray a lot. I study a lot. I pray some more. I study some more. God, what is it you're trying to say? What is the one thing I need to get across? What is the different thing? Yes, the resistance, that's an important point. And the rescue, that's an important point. But I believe that those are not the story here. I don't want you to miss it, that the whole idea of resistance, how can we resist authority? How can we accomplish that? Don't you want to have the faith of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Don't you want to be like Daniel, dare to be a Daniel? Of course you do. Of course we do. How do we get that place? What makes the story is not the act of resistance, or even the act of rescue. The thing that made the resistance possible and the rescue necessary was the fact that these men had what I'm going to call a holy disinterest in what might happen to them. I'm not saying they were uninterested, because that means indifferent. How many people couldn't care less what happens to them in life? How many people just say, I don't care if I get hit by that car, I'm going to walk on. That doesn't make sense. We're not uninterested. But there's a sense of being disinterested. Disinterest means this. It means to not have any stake in the outcome of a situation. To say, no matter what happens, I'm good with this. Yes, I would like to be delivered from the burning fiery furnace. I don't think the three guys said, oh, I've always wanted to go out this way. Bring it on. He did 8 times higher. No, they weren't wanting it. They were wanting God's will. But because they wanted God's will, they were not interested in their own well-being. See, the important thing for them was trusting the sovereign God who can do what he wants to do. They knew God's will. Obedience was their only option. So they were able to give up control of their lives, of their very destinies, to another. And I take that from verse 17 and the phrase that is used there. The phrase indicates possibility, not certainty. Look at it again. If that is the case, our God, whom we serve, is what? He is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And he will deliver us if he wants to. But the key is, what does God want? It's not talking certainty. They're not naming it and claiming it. They're saying God can do what he wants. And what he wants, I want. They're saying, I have no opinion in this once God has spoken. That's what they're saying. They're saying, I don't care. D.L. Moody one time was on a boat going from Chicago over to Michigan, and Lake Michigan is deep, and it can get scary when the storms come. It was a small boat, and there was a big storm. And so he was a famous man. People knew. One passenger came up, fellow passenger, said, Dr. Moody, aren't you afraid that the storm's going to come, and we're going to capsize, and you're going to die? And D.L. Moody said, no, I have a brother in Michigan, and I have a brother in heaven, and I don't care which one I see first. That's a holy disinterest. If God takes me, great. So they were saying, if he saves us, great. If we die, also great. See, if it wasn't for that holy disinterest in the outcome, they wouldn't have been able to resist. They would have been fearful. But once you make a decision, whatever God wants is what I want, they can't do anything to you. Because you know something? You've died already. If the worst thing someone can do to you is to kill you, and you've already given yourself to the Lord, that even becomes not something that you fear. You don't want it. You're human. You're normal. But you're able to say, you know something? It doesn't matter, because what counts is what God wants. And he's sovereign. Isn't this what Jesus said in the Garden of Gethsemane? Not my will, but thine be done. Isn't that a holy disinterest in what happens to him? Because the most important thing, listen, the most important thing was what God wanted. So in his humanity, Jesus, who never sinned, but had a desire to not go to the cross, I understand that. But then he immediately said, nevertheless, I don't care. If you want me to do this, I want what you want. Listen, no matter what happens as a consequence, you can't do anything to a person like that, because they're already where they need to be. Isn't that what Queen Esther said in Persia when she was facing down certain death herself? And she said, and so I will go to the king, which is against the law, and if I perish, I perish. She was dead already, as far as she was concerned, right? The worst thing they can do is kill me, and then I get to be with God. You know, the worst thing that happens to a Christian is not death, right? That frees us. And so the idea there is to have a disinterest in our will. See, here's what I want you to see. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did not have faith in a miracle. They had faith in the Master. It wasn't, I'll have faith if this happens. It's, I don't care what happens. I have a sovereign God, and what I want is what he wants. That is the difference in having faith. So sometimes people talk about faith, and they're praying for a miracle, and they're believing for a miracle. And I'm not trying to take away from that in a specific, but I do want you to think about that in general, because you might not get that. There are a lot of people that aren't delivered from the fire. It doesn't matter in the big scheme of things, because God's will is to be done. We're supposed to pray every day, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And thy will be done means my will be undone. And that's going to cost you something. Are you willing to pay the cost? Esther was. I love what Paul says in Romans 14:8. For if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. Isn't that a holy disinterest in what happens to you? If I live, it's for Jesus. If I die, it's for Jesus. Either way, it's Jesus. That's why he said, I want to go to heaven to be with the Lord, but to stay here is more important for you, so I'll stay. Or I'll go. Or I'll stay. It's up to God. And so it takes you out of the picture. And it makes it all about the Lord that we say we love anyway. When you don't care how it will affect you, you can really trust in God. Rest on his promises. Be secure in his presence through flame or blood. That, I think, is the important part of the story. We can spend a long time with the fourth man in the fire. And what a blessing that is. But I want you to see that you wouldn't be in the fire if you didn't say, thy will be done. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes for a moment. I'd like the message to be something we take beyond noon, you know. So we get noon's over. It's time to go home and have some wonderful food with our wonderful families. But I want you to think about this, please. With your eyes closed and your head bowed, I would like you, if you're feeling you should, don't say it if you don't mean it, right? to make a commitment to God above, to say, I surrender my life to you in all areas and all capacities. May your will be done, not mine. And I will gladly accept whatever the consequences are of this decision. Take a moment, please, and we'll call you back with music. But take a moment in the silence. Say, Jesus, it's all you. No matter what happens, I'm yours. I have a holy disinterest in myself because I have a huge interest in you. I'm asking you to make that commitment so you leave different than you came in. Before we sing this closing song, we just have the lyrics put up on the screen. I like to just speak the lyrics, just recite them before we sing them, and just really focus on giving ourselves to Him. Make me, mold me, use me, fill me. I give my life to the potter's hand. Call me, guide me, lead me. Walk beside me. I give my life to the potter's hand. Somebody else can't give you, you give you. And then He wants to use us. What a thrill to be able to make a difference. Can you imagine how the world would take notice if we lived like this for Jesus? Right? All the problems, all the things that we fight over, the little nitty-gritty minor things, if we would just give it all to Jesus and just say, hey, I'm here in the name of Jesus. What I have, you need. Let me share. I hope you'll do that. I hope you'll give yourself entirely to the Lord. And that we can go and make a difference for Jesus in the world that He said. Thank you, Father God. Thank you for bringing us together. Thank you for this church that I love and this city that I love. Thank you, Father God. You've given us a gospel that we love and a message to go And I pray, help us to get ourselves out of the way and to be so full of you that there's no room for us. That, Father God, we would have a holy disinterest in ourselves, in our own well-being, in our will, in our ideas, and we'd be so caught up in you that Jesus would be the only thing that defines us. And people would say, they've been with Jesus, and I want some of that. Jesus, it can happen. You can change. You can challenge. You can fix our community as you change individual souls. So, Father, help us to be part of that great plan. As we leave, you bless us in the gathering. Oh, use us in this gathering, we pray. In Jesus' glorious name, amen.